Good morning, MacNab. Welcome to another edition of Online Church. It's Sunday, May 10th, and we are so glad to have you here with us this morning. We have a really great morning of worship planned for you. Happy Mother's Day to everyone who is celebrating today. We're glad that you're spending some time with us here. A few days ago, I asked some of the moms in our congregation to share some of their thoughts around Mother's Day with us. But before we get to that, I just want to take a moment to acknowledge that for some of us, this is a tricky day. Whether we have lost our moms or have difficult relationships with moms or kids, or maybe you're not a mom at all, by chance or by choice, whatever your circumstances are, if self-isolation has you down this morning because you're away from your loved ones, I just want to remind you that we here at MacNab, we love you, we care about you, and more importantly, God loves you and He cares about you. He sees your heart. He knows the situation that you're in, and He has come alongside you this morning to offer you His love and His comfort. Let's get to our videos.
Good morning, church family, and happy Mother's Day. This is the first year that I not only get to celebrate all the incredible women in my life, but I also get to reflect on what it means to be a mother myself, and for that I'm very grateful. I know that my role as a mother will change and evolve as my daughter grows up. And so to all the more experienced moms out there, know that you are not only just a very important role model to your own children, but also to a first-time mom like me. So to all of you, happy Mother's Day.
Good morning, everyone. Every Mother's Day, I always think of my mom. Being adopted, one of the greatest experiences I was able to share with her was my pregnancy of our first child. As she had never carried a child herself, she followed my pregnancy and was absolutely delighted to come to the hospital and meet our firstborn, Colin. We were blessed with three more sons who called me mom and called her nanny. This is my fifth Mother's Day without her, and I miss her every day. I look forward to the day when I become a new kind of mother, a grandmother. It won't be anytime soon, as my children are all starting their careers, so we look forward to that day when we become grandparents. Happy Mother's Day, everybody. We look forward to seeing you again very soon.
Hello, MacNab friends. What does Mother's Day mean to me? Mother's Day is breakfast in bed, flowers, lots of homemade cards when the kids were small, and now that they're older, Mother's Day is a chance for me to be thankful and grateful for four wonderful children who bring me so much joy, and also thankful to my own mother for being such a wonderful mom to me. My wish for you is that you could have just a little slice on Mother's Day of whatever makes you the happiest. One of my favorite things is a cup of coffee or something else, a really good book, a cozy blanket, and a comfy chair for a good couple hours. Happy Mother's Day.
What being a mom means to me is I'll know what it feels like to experience unconditional love. It means I'll be raising them to be the best they can be, to guide them through life. It means I'm forever a superhero. It means I'll give endless hugs and kisses. Being a mom means you're tied to another soul for life. It means you're Mrs. Fix-It and you can fix everything. I love being a mom. Happy Mother's Day.
Christina asked me to share what I think Mother's Day is about. Well, I think that Mother's Day is all about love and showing that love. And by showing that love, I don't mean gifts that you might buy. The best gifts are the ones that come from the heart. When my daughters were little, I always used to tell them as part of our bedtime routine that they were my gifts from God. One of my very favorite Mother's Day presents was when one of them told me that I was their gift from God. I wish all the mums watching a very happy Mother's Day.
Hi, my name is Nicole, and as a mom of two teenagers, or I would say young adults, what does Mother's Day remind me of? Well, on Mother's Day, I think about my children and the various stages of growth that they've gone through. I think of them as babies where they need you for everything. And I remember the exhaustion and the lack of sleep. And I also remember the times when they're asleep, and I think this is the most beautiful thing that I've ever seen. Right now, I can go through all the other years, but right now I'm going through the transition stage of them leaving home, and I'm going through a vast array of emotions. I am proud, I am happy, I am sad, but most of all, I'm proud because I'm proud of the wonderful people that they've grown to be. So for all the mothers out there, I just want to say that your children are a reflection of the time you spent with them, and you love them enough that you let them go. And happy Mother's Day, and blessings to you all.
Thanks, Christina. It's great to be with you all this morning to worship together. Let's join our hearts together in prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity to worship together, to tell you how much we love you, and to seek your help for the days ahead. Father, we especially thank you that today is Mother's Day, and for many of us, that means a day of celebration. For others of us, it's a mixed day, Lord, and it's a day where some of us are seeking your comfort in a special way. We thank you that wherever we find ourselves, you'll meet us right where we are, and you'll help us take the next step. So we pray that we would look to you for that help today. And we pray this in Jesus' name, with the prayer our Savior taught us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Lorianne is now going to read the scriptures for us.
Thanks, Steve, and good morning, everyone. I am reading this morning from Matthew 5, 3, verse 12, verse 3 to 12. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you.
How can you possibly be happy when you are mourning over something? We come to the second beatitude this morning, and Jesus says, blessed are those who mourn. Happy are you when you're weeping over something. It makes about as much sense to me as saying, you know, be happy if you've lost your best friend or just lost your job. Jesus, in the Beatitudes, I believe, is God the Creator telling us as his creation what it is that will make us happy. And that might spark our interest. It might cause us to lean in to hear what he has to say, but we just as quickly lean out when we hear some of the details of what he says. The Beatitudes are counterintuitive. They invite us to things that we wouldn't first gravitate towards. And yet I'd ask you to stick with them. And here's why. Because some of the things that we intuitively lean towards in the hopes of finding happiness don't deliver. We look for pleasure or possessions or money or status or popularity. And even once we get those things, we still don't find that we're happy. The Beatitudes definitely are asking us to embrace something different, but it truly is the Creator inviting us to embrace His prescription for happiness. And we began to see last week how, even though at first blush they don't seem to make sense, that when we dig a little bit deeper, they do make sense. For example, last week we looked at that beatitude when Jesus said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." It doesn't sound very appealing. But when we unpack it a little more, we realize that Jesus, talking about the poor of his day, we're talking about people who had no options. And for me to adopt the posture of being poor in spirit before God is for me to say, God, you are my only option. You are the only fuel that will truly energize my life. It's kind of like first aid when you learn breathing bleeding bones, and you know that if you come up to somebody in a first aid situation and they need help, the first thing you do is check to whether or not they're breathing. And that breathing then informs the next thing that you do and the next thing. You wouldn't go up to somebody and start treating a broken leg if they weren't breathing. Jesus invites us, I believe, to embrace that foundational paradigm of being poor in spirit as we now move into the second beatitude, which is, blessed are those who mourn. Mourn over what? Mourn because of what? Once again, in the context of recognizing our poverty of spirit, our need for only God to be that fuel that energizes, that drives us, I believe that the mourning is a mourning over sin, or being remorseful, over those things that keep me from experiencing God's fullness. And that's exactly what sin does. When you hear the word sin, you may be thinking of specific sins, like things that are mentioned in the Ten Commandments, like, you know, do not murder, do not steal, do not lie, do not covet. And those are sins, and those are specific sins, specific examples of sins. But the word sin itself in the Bible refers to missing a mark. It's actually an archery term referring to when you don't hit the bullseye with an arrow. Well, what mark are we missing when it comes to sin? We're missing the mark of putting God at the center of our life. And yes, there are specific sins, but whatever the specifics, whatever the sin, all sin comes down to me missing the mark in one way or another, whether a little or whether a lot. I talked last week about resisting the temptation to compare ourselves to others. And I would say it again when it comes to this matter of sin. By that I mean, don't get into the delusion of saying, well, yes, I sin, but not as bad as other people. Yeah, I tell a fib, I maybe lose my temper, but I'm not a murderer. I'm not a thief. I haven't stolen big things anyways. The danger in that kind of comparison is we develop even a pride over comparing ourselves to one another. And by the way, pride as well as a sin. But comparing ourselves to one another doesn't draw us any closer to God. The Apostle Paul in Romans 3 sort of levels the playing field when he says this. If you're tempted to say, well, maybe I sin, but I don't sin as bad as someone else. Listen to what Paul says in Romans 3:23. For everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. Comparing whether or not I think I don't fall as short as others really doesn't get me anywhere. It doesn't change the fact that I fall short, because Paul says everyone does. If you can imagine maybe a high jumping contest to a ledge that's 100 feet above ground, and on that ledge is a pot of gold. And if you can, from standing on the ground, jump 100 feet up to that level, you'll get the gold. Well, some of us might come and we might jump 2 feet. Others of us might jump 5 feet. Others of us jump might 10 feet. But none of us are going to get to that 100-foot mark. We all fall short. Some of us fall short perhaps more than others, but what does it matter? Nobody gets the gold. And in that regard, all of us can mourn. All of us can be remorseful over sin because we've failed to embrace that fullness that God invites us to experience. Here's my paraphrase of the second beatitude. Happiness, blessedness, comes to those who are remorseful about choices that keep them from experiencing God's fullness. Happy or blessed are those who are remorseful about choices that keep them from experiencing God's fullness. It just doesn't speak to the things that I do. It speaks to my desires at my very core. And to be remorseful about those things that keep me from experiencing God's fullness is a good thing. I'm mourning over something, but that mourning, that kind of weeping, that kind of remorse, that's a good thing. It's a blessed thing. When my heart breaks over the things that I know break God's heart, that's a good thing for me. Just imagine with me for a moment that I said something to my wife that was unkind and hurtful. It would be a good thing if I was remorseful over having said that. It's appropriate that if I've broken her heart, that knowing that would also break my heart. And even though I did a bad thing in hurting my wife, it's a good thing that I'm remorseful about it. In that sense, mourning over my sin would be a good thing. So when I mourn over something I said to Andrea that might have hurt her feelings, when I'm remorseful about that, it communicates to her that I regret causing her that hurt, that I don't want to be that kind of person that causes hurt, that I want better things for our relationship. Well, we say the same thing to God when we are remorseful over sin. Blessed are those who mourn over their sin, for they shall be comforted. Comforted. How does that happen? When I acknowledge my sin, when I confess my remorse over what keeps me from embracing God first, God meets us in our mourning. And he meets us with grace and with forgiveness and with comfort. Psalm 32 says, when I acknowledged my sin to you and did not hide my iniquity, you forgave the guilt of my sin. The Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians 7 verse 10 says, godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. Why does God respond to us that way? When we come to him remorseful over those things that keep us from embracing him fully, remorseful over our sin. Because that is how a good parent treats their child. And God is the ultimate loving, good parent. He invites us, Jesus invites us, to come to God as our Heavenly Father. And loving parents respond to their children with comfort, with love, with forgiveness. I'm going to finish this morning with a little bit of a lengthy story about my mom. It's Mother's Day, and it makes perfect sense to tell this story, one, because it's Mother's Day, and because, two, this story explains for me or points me to the comfort of God, probably like very few other stories. For me, this story is about the biggest failure in my whole life with my mom. And there may be other people that I respect equally to my mother in this world, but there is no one who I respect more. My dad died when I was 5. And my mother very immediately became a single mom, did an amazing job. The older I get, the more amazing that job is when I see what she's done and I reflect on it. So what happened? What's the story that I'm going to tell you about my mom? Well, I got to go way back, a few years, when I was 27. And the year I was 27 was arguably the busiest year of my life. I took on way too much. I was involved in a church as a youth pastor, and the youth ministry took off. In fact, it was growing so fast, it felt like it just had exploded. It was, things were happening so quickly. And I was also a youth consultant for another organization. And if that wasn't enough, I decided that year, when I was 27, the year was 1988, that I would run a short-term missions project out of my youth group. And I ended up taking 20 kids along with three other adult leaders to Central America for a 29-day trip that involved lots of preparation, lots of training, lots of organization, lots of work, and lots of time. In addition to that, that was the same year that the Billy Graham organization decided that they wanted to run a crusade in the city of Hamilton. It was called the Golden Horseshoe Billy Graham Crusade. It happened in October of 1988, and they asked me to be the youth director for that crusade. And by the way, if you don't know who Billy Graham is, he's probably the biggest deal in evangelism, certainly in our era. He preached, I think, to a total of about 210 million people in 185 different countries and territories. But as youth director for this event that took place over five nights in Hamilton, it meant me networking with other youth groups all across the Golden Horseshoe, doing seminars, running high school assemblies, concerts, not to mention the endless meetings that took place within the context of the executive committee of that crusade. Why am I telling you all this? Well, because to say that I was busy that year was an understatement. 1988 was the busiest year of my life. Just at the end of 1987, I did what everybody back then did. I bought a new day planner for 1988, and I began populating it with all the busy things that I had to do. And I actually bought a different planner than what I had used for several years leading up to that. And what I found was when I started getting into 1988, this new day planner just wasn't working for me. I had to go back to my old one. So I went back to the office supply store that I bought it from. I bought a new one, which was actually the old one that I used to have, the old kind that I used to have. And then I painstakingly transferred all of my appointments from my first book for 1988 into my second book for 1988. Every appointment except one. There was one appointment that purely, for whatever reason, I don't know, I accidentally overlooked and did not transfer. And this was it. It was the date that my mom was to have a surgery. I was going through all my busy days in 1988, and one morning the phone rang when I was still at home, and it was my mom's voice on the other end of the phone, and me, being the great son that I am, said, "Hey, Mom, how are you?" And what came back to me was a very weary voice that said, "Well, I'm doing better now that I'm out of the hospital." At that moment, my awareness of what had happened fell on me like an avalanche. And realizing that I had missed my mom's surgery, I had put it in my date book the first time, and I had planned to be there that day. I had planned to be the supportive, encouraging, comforting son that I wanted to be. I missed the whole thing. I talked to Mom for a minute, then I immediately called my office, said cancel all my appointments that day, and I got in the car and I began driving. It was about a two and a half, two and three quarter hour drive sobbing all the way. And I remember when I got to Mom's house, I went in through the kitchen into the living room. She was lying on the couch. And I went and I kneeled down beside the couch and I put my head down at her hand. And I apologized. I told her how sorry I was for what for me was a massive failure. And all that came back from my mom was assurance, compassion, and comfort. My mother lived another 16 years, and that day never came up again. She never brought it up. It was like it never happened. Why do I tell you that story? Well, Jesus, in his teaching, one day said this: if you human parents know how to look after your kids as well as you do, and you do a good job looking after your kids, how much more so do you think my Father in heaven wants to look after you, wants to comfort you? My mother's compassion and comfort reminds me. It points me. And it assures me of God's comfort when I come to Him. Thanks, Mom. Jesus said, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted." I'd like to invite Nancy and Jess, a mother and daughter, who lead worship in our first service at MacNab called Gathering. They are going to sing a song called Reckless Love. Our Gathering band director, Miriam, laid down the piano tracks and sent it to them this week, and then they put it together. And this song is both a prayer to God and a celebration of God's comforting care. Please, as you hear this song, take time to reflect, and then Christina will close for us in prayer.
Miriam chose this piece for celebrating mothers because a mother's love for her children compares to God's love for us. We hope the message conveys the songwriter's meaning, that this type of love considers others first. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. And I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Oh, the
Thank you, Jess and Nancy, for that beautiful song. Thank you, Steve, for words of wisdom. Let us pray. Father God, thank you again that we can be together this morning. Lord, we continue to lift up our healthcare workers and other essential workers to you. Give them strength and peace during this time. God, we continue to ask that you bring an end to this horrible pandemic. And God, we pray that you would give us a heart like yours so that what matters to you matters to us. Father, some of us have needs that we need to speak aloud or within our own hearts, and some of us have people that we need to lift up to you. And so, God, we just ask that you would be with us as we take a moment to do so. Thank you, God, for all the blessings you continue to pour out over us. Please be with us this week. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to turn it back over to Steve to offer the benediction.
Thanks, Christina. Before the benediction, I just want to thank everyone who participated in our service this morning, and thank you for joining us this morning. I'd also like to remind you that MacNab is now Zooming twice on Wednesdays at 10 a.m. and 7 p.m. And if you're interested in participating in that, the links go out when you reply to my weekly email. If you're not getting my weekly email, just write me at macnabstreet@gmail.com and I'll add you to the list. Also, thanks to everyone who has been faithfully participating in our offerings over these past several weeks. And if you would like to participate in giving at MacNab, right now, if you're not already pre-registered, there's really only two options. One is the donate tab on our website, macnabpresbyterian.ca, or you can mail a check to the church office if it is safe for you to do so. And again, we thank you for your support and your consideration. Last but not least, after the benediction, I invite you to linger and reflect for a moment as we listen to an organ postlude previously recorded by MacNab's organist, Gerald. God bless you and thanks for coming. Now, may God go before you to lead you. May God go behind you to protect you. May God go beneath you to support you. May God go beside you to befriend you. Do not be afraid. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Do not be afraid. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord together. Amen.